It's my pleasure to introduce the session. I am Lynn Wu. I'm a professor at the Operation Information Management Department at the Wharton School. My research is about how social networks affect work dynamics as well as performance of individual knowledge workers as well as firms. And this is a really exciting area, especially with the recent rise of social media and various technologies that capture lots of our human interaction, very fine-grained interactions, online and offline. So I use a lot of these digital traits in my work, and I'm really excited to hear our panelists today. All three of them are experts in this area, in social network, as well as performance analytics. So let me introduce our first speaker, Professor Rob Cross. Professor Cross is at the University of Virginia. He's one of the pioneers in using social network analysis in understanding work performance. And I've been reading his papers since I was a doctoral student. Right. Next, we have Dr. Ben Waber. Oh, there it is, yes. Ben is a CEO and president of Sociometric Solutions, now Humanize. He received his PhD at MIT Media Lab. And since the MIT days, he has been working to understand how we can apply technology to capture human interactions, analytics. And Ben has been productive in multiple fronts. As of 5 weeks ago, he became a father of a baby boy. Yay. Lastly, we have Dr. Michael Arena. Mike is the Chief Talent Officer at the General Motors. He's also the board chair at Plexus Institute. Mike has been working extensively on strategic workforce analytics, talent acquisition, as well as leadership development. Despite working at an automobile company, Mike is really an avid biker. So when given the chance, he would rather ride his bike than drive his car. So let's welcome our panelists.
I want you to think about a typical work week. And I know everybody will say, I never have one, but imagine you had a typical work week. And I want you to reflect for a second on the amount of time you spend in the following three activities, cumulatively, percentage-wise, right? So a typical work week, cumulative time on the phone, on email, or in meetings, virtual or face-to-face. And think about the volume of work that takes. And if I had a little bit more time, we'd poll the room. And generally what you hear is the number started about 80% for most people these days. It goes to 90%, and then somebody at 110% that's really pissed off, right, with the amount of work that's going home with them in different ways. And what's been interesting to me in looking at networks analytically is the explosion of that collaborative aspect of work. If I asked that same question 10 years ago, it used to start at 60 or lower. And generally, if we look across about 300 organizations we've worked with over the past two decades in applying these analytic ideas to look at collaboration, we've seen over the past decade more than a 50% rise in the collaborative intensity of work and the diversity, the cognitive diversity of it. And so it's putting a huge strain on organizations, this collaborative aspect, yet there's very little focus on understanding the cost of it, right, or what these collaborations look like. There's no chief collaborative overload officer. There's nobody that's really thinking about how do we manage the connective tissue as well as the individual human capital in organizations. And so we've worked, again, for about two decades thinking about if you could see these networks, if you could take a lens into how work was happening in groups that you cared about, what kind of perspectives would it give you, particularly from a human capital or people management standpoint we'll take today. I'll talk a little bit about some broad ideas, and then Ben will talk about ways of using these ideas from a passive standpoint, Michael more from an innovation and application within GM and some other places. But the idea is that if you can understand, you know, who's turning to whom for information to get work done, it just gives you a different lens to be thinking about what's important to manage. So this is an example from my first book. Major petrochemical organizations, they were losing hundreds of millions of dollars in their deep sea drilling area because they weren't moving best practices well across deep sea drilling platforms. I was running a research group at IBM at the time, so we had thrown databases at it. We'd done everything technically, and yet they still weren't getting the performance improvement. So they said, can we look at how we're collaborating? Who's turning to whom for information to get work done in this context? On the left, or your right, I'm sorry, you see a network of who's turning to whom for information, and there's a line between one or two people if one or the other said, this is a really important source of information for me. This is somebody I really rely on to get things done. And if you contrast it with the formal structure, of course, this isn't the whole group, right? The real group is 7,000 people. I'm just kind of pulling up an example to give you an exemplar of the kind of things we've seen over 20 years, 300 organizations doing this about 800 times, right? To give you a sense of why you should care. If you take a look at it, Mitchell starts to jump out, right, as being pretty influential. And what we can expect from a people analytics standpoint, almost any group we look at inside organizations or between organizations, is that about 3 to 5% of the people tend to account for about 20 to 35% of the value-added ties in most places. And then, of course, there's never one Mitchell, right? There can be hundreds of Mitchells if we're looking at a larger and larger group. The interesting thing about it to us has been more recently, as companies have given us performance data over the past decade or so, that if we compare our list of the Mitchells, those people that are having the biggest collaborative impact, against the company's list of who they're paying the most in the top talent programs, in the top 20% rating systems, there's typically 50% or less overlap, right, between the list. So at some level, a lot of these great places, I mean, people in this room that are spending a lot of time evaluating talent are not, considering a collaborative aspect of it, right? And they're susceptible. For example, if Mitchell leaves, because he or she is not getting acknowledged in certain ways, bonuses and things like that, it has a pretty big impact on the group. Right, it's not just what he knows that he's walking out the door with, it's the way that group gets worked on that becomes susceptible in that context. So 3 to 5%, 20 to 35% of the value-added ties in most places, and we're typically looking at two kinds of people in the center of these networks. First, where are decision rights not well allocated, information getting stuck, portions of role not really well thought out that are keeping work from happening in different ways. So in this case, Mitchell just owned access to a certain database that was forcing everybody to come to him. 10 years ago that had made sense, but as they'd grown, remember the real group was 7,000 people, high fixed asset cost structure, the delays that were introduced, not by him hoarding information, but just trying to keep up, were millions and millions of dollars, right? And so if you can see that and think not about how do we think about networking as just building out more connectivity, but shifting information, shifting decision rights to make the whole group more effective, that's pretty important. Second is who are the stars you're missing, right? If Mitchell isn't getting acknowledged and he or she leaves, what impact does that have? Second category of people that we're always interested are who are those on the fringe and not getting brought in. And from a people analytics standpoint, there tend to be two categories that we always focus on intentionally. First are the newcomers. So in most strong culture companies, if we start coloring the nodes in here by tenure bands, we can see that it typically takes 3 to 5 years for people to get into a productive position in a network, right, to replicate the networks of the high performers. And we've learned a lot about how companies can streamline that, right, and actually get people engaged much more quickly, not endure that long, presumably process that has to happen as people get accustomed to the person. Second thing, from any of you all dealing with bonus intensive work, we can typically expect about 20% of your quote unquote high performers to be way on the fringe, right? So they've figured out how to hit their own numbers and they're making a tremendous amount of money, but they're not providing introductions back. They're not doing other things that get a multiplier effect on their abilities, right? And so in some instances, it's worth thinking about how do you get better leverage from them. Not in all cases, right? There's some people on the fringe, if you're in R&D groups, that you don't want to push in, right? Because you're going to start to affect the external connectivity they have. There's other groups that you may be worried about pushing people in that could have a negative impact, but in the right instances, it can help you start to see how and where do we need to get better connectivity or collaboration. Third, a little bit more subtly, if you read Malcolm Gladwell's book, The Tipping Point, or others that talk about these inflection point people, are what I'll call brokers, that get in these networks and they're important not because of the volume of ties, but because of the number of bridging ties. We know from a change perspective, if you can get them engaged, great things can happen. From an innovation standpoint, if you get them engaged, great things happen. But they're traditionally invisible, right, in most places. So if I compare the list that a company gives me of who they think the McWaters are, the people that have these bridging ties across functions, against who is actually in those positions, there's typically less than 30% overlap because they're in the white space. They don't necessarily are popular in any one area, but they're important because they have ideas that can be brought into other perspectives and have a big impact. And then last are silos. Where do you see certain collaborative breakdowns in these networks that you care about? And from a people standpoint, there's not a single company that has been part of our group. We have a consortium of about 100 organizations now. I can't name a single one of them that isn't talking about we need to be one firm, a global organization, leverage synergies, all this stuff. And yet you go inside there and you start looking in large groups about where the silos exist, and there's a tremendous number of breakdowns a lot of times across geographies, capabilities, functional lines. We're never coming back saying everybody should be connected to everybody else, right? Because we're all overwhelmed in different ways. But what we do see is how and where do we go in and find, you know, five or six junctures that if you don't get right are going to strategically undercut you, either for innovation purposes, for efficiency gains, whatever may have an impact like that. So when you take a look at this and you start applying and really saying, gosh, this collaborative intensity of work has risen, you start to see different inflection points, different ways of thinking about who really matters, how to protect people from leaving, where inefficiencies are happening. And from an analytics standpoint, it's more than just looking at the diagrams. And the thought that I wanted to kind of end on and leave you with as a group here is that we can take these ideas and not just show these diagrams that get very busy and hard to interpret, but we can break it down and really start to see who are the key players in an organization and how do we just make sure that we're paying attention to them from a talent standpoint. So it's a simple dashboard view. You're looking from top to bottom, the people that are most sought out within this group. It's a real group, but heavily disguised, so you can't pick out industry or anything like that. So you see the first person has 95 incoming ties, and the next question is this somebody the company's paying attention to, right? Have they been identified as top talent or not? And you see that there's a whole bunch of no's in that column as you look down there, right? And if you've done one of these, you've probably been through the experience of sitting with a leader and they look down the list and they're going to get the first three or four right, you know, intuitively you're going to pick that out, but then all of a sudden the surprises start coming in and you really start thinking about, are we susceptible to losing this person? Did we just overlook them for promotion? What are the things that we've done wrong there? The last two columns here to the right are different network dimensions that are really worth thinking about. Around one is what we always look at is this idea of energy. And if we're doing a survey-based approach, we can ask this question, who do you interact with and actually walk away feeling better, God forbid, right, about what you're up to at work, or who just sucks the life out of you, right, and kind of pulls the energy out of you. And what this is showing is the percent of connections in each person's network that people say, you know what, this person energizes me, typically, not all the time, but typically. And it can be really powerful to see above and below the trend line where there are behaviors you want to address or where there are change agents that you want to pull on, not just because they're informationally connected, but because they energize the group. And the last one that we always look at from a human capital standpoint is where are people saying they need greater access to certain people? Not just who you're getting information from, but where are people saying that they need greater connectivity to a given individual? Because this helps us see, you know, bottlenecks in different ways, right? Not just people that are informationally connected, but how and where people like, let's say, a Joshua in this list are heavily overwhelmed. Because the typical tendency a lot of times in most organizations we've been in is if people get popular, they get good, then they get promoted into the next responsibility, but nothing is done to take the collaborative demands off them. And so there's this progression until people start to burn out. We're seeing they turn over more. A lot of negative things happen like that. Okay, so I want to level set and say, what have we seen over about a 20-year period, around 300 organizations? Give a context for why some of these analytics have impact from a people standpoint. Ben will come up now and give a little bit of a flavor of how to capture some of the data, some really interesting things you can use from a technical standpoint here.
All right, so while I'm waiting for my slides to come up, actually maybe I'll just start out with a question. Just thinking about everybody who's here today and everyone had a nice breakfast over there, unless you're celebrating Passover and then you're just staring longingly at the bagels. So just thinking about the average person today, all the participants here, I want you to just, we're just gonna have a little vote. How many people on average do you think we talked to today? So I wanna just show a hand. So who thinks we talked to more than 20 people on average? Okay, maybe, all right, 15 to 20, 10 to 15, all right, and less than 10. A couple people maybe a little tired in the morning feeling like we probably didn't talk to too many people. Some people really feel like, everyone was really social this morning. But here's the issue with that. There's one objective right answer about what actually happened. The problem that we have when we've really tried to assess how do people interact and collaborate at work, like what's actually happening, is we have two ways to do that. I will either ask you, which I just did, or I'll have someone follow you around with a notebook. And that's a little creepy, having someone with a notebook, you know, writing down everything you do. But those were the best tools that we had available. And it's only recently that has begun to change, that new data sources have become available that really enable us to objectively measure people at previously unimaginable levels. We're generating email data, IM data, phone call data about the digital side of what we do. But increasingly on the physical side, we're carrying around sensors with us. We're carrying around cell phones, company ID badges that can actually measure who we talk to in person. And you might think, well, you know, this really just enables this, the same sort of things we were doing before. But throughout history, new data has fundamentally changed how we view the universe. And I think a good example of this is thinking about the telescope. When the telescope was invented, you know, previously the best way we had to follow the position of the stars at night was literally people were writing down, they'd literally point to the sky, they'd say, I think the star is there, and they'd write down a little note about it. Well, now all of a sudden you had a machine that could do that at previously unimaginable levels of accuracy. And it's not surprising that years after the invention of this device, that we were able to actually formulate accurate models of the solar system. Something as basic as new data completely changed how humanity viewed themselves in the universe. And that's incredibly powerful. And I think we're in a similar place when it comes to the world of work. Essentially today, when it comes to understanding people, the stuff that we tend to look at is, I like to look at the stuff on the left, right? I like to look at org charts. I like to look at processes because I can understand that stuff. I can point to the person at the top, and as Rob was showing, I can think that that's the most important person in the company, but it's all the informal stuff that's going on that we're missing. But because of all these devices that we're carrying with us, because of all this data we're generating, we can start to use devices like augmented ID badges, which is what I developed in my research, and then we've spun off into a company, that can all of a sudden start to figure out, you know, who's talking to who? How do people talk to each other? Not what they say, but looking at how much you interrupt someone, what percent of time you talk, and you can start to answer very basic questions, fundamental questions of how we work. How much does sales talk to engineering? I can go to, I would imagine, any one of your organizations today, and I would not be able to get an accurate answer, unless maybe you're one of our customers, and then get a very accurate answer. But at the same time, you know, I could look at, all right, if you're a retailer, how much should you talk to a customer in a store? If you can't answer those questions, I mean, how can you hope to optimize your business, to improve what you do? I mean, those are hugely important questions for what you do. And so what I want to talk about now is actually deploying this kind of technology, these sensors in real companies, and seeing what could we learn. The first company we're going to look at is this big IT firm. Right, and these people are configuring multi-million dollar server systems. Okay, so I'm going to show you a group, about 50 people, and they're paid on an individual basis. So you get a task where a salesperson calls you up and says, here, I need you to configure this multi-million dollar server system, and you get paid based on how quickly you turn that around. It can take you 5 minutes, it can actually take you 8 hours if it's really hard. But what's very interesting is, so from this company, I know exactly when people started working on a task, and I know exactly when they completed it. Now with these devices, I can start to look at, who did you talk to when you were working on a task? Just a very simple question. And I want you to think about what happens when you have a problem at work. So typically, you know, if I have a question, what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask an expert. I'm going to ask Al, right? And I'll talk to Al, and Al will probably give me a good idea about how to solve this problem I've been working on. But of course, you know, in our company, there's not just one Al. There's lots of Al's. And at this company was no different. There's actually four Al's. And if you talk to one of those people, you completed your task in a third of the time that it normally took you. There's a massive impact. On the other hand, the individual performance of those people was just about average. These people were getting paid less than the so-called experts, as Rob was talking about, because they were focused on helping everyone else. They were spending hours of their day making the entire division better. And so the issue here is that we can use this to, for example, change how people are compensated, and instead change compensation from purely individual to now based on groups, and that's exactly what we did here. In addition to that, even implemented policies like at the group stand-ups where every day you would call out people who help you. So they get promoted, and I would argue that this company, they shouldn't care about individual performance. If you spend 5 hours of your day helping the people you work with be more effective, that should be your job. There's just been no way to measure that contribution before, but now we can. I'll show you one more example. of actually retail banks in Europe. And I'm just going to show you the networks from a couple of these banks. So we've got three branches here. So I guess on your left, you'll see branch one, where pretty much everyone talks to everybody else. In branch two, we've got two factions that sort of emerge, and that's interesting. And then in branch three, you see a really tightly knit core, and you see these three lonely people on the outside. So branch one did have the highest performance. Branch three was close, but those three outliers really dragged everyone else down. And so just to give you more of a sense of what this branch actually does, these people sell small business loans. And you're, again, paid on an individual basis. But in these branches, in, like the one you see on the left, management had implemented an informal sort of bonus process, where essentially if the entire branch hit a certain performance target, everyone got paid. So they incentivize people to share, and it has an effect on how people actually behave. In branch two, we saw actually a lot of branches like this. And it turns out these branches were split across two floors and had a huge impact on how information is shared from one floor to the other. In branch three, we saw a lot of divisions, branches like this as well, where these outliers, these people who only talk to one person, only talk to their manager, they're all the new employees. But again, these are things where these branches are so, you know, again, so tightly knit that it's very hard to integrate new people. And so what this bank did is they took these, again, automatically identified these best practices and used them to A-B test, to test out all these things across different branches in the company. And they were actually able to increase top-line sales, loan sales, by 11%, which is, this is hundreds of millions of dollars a year. Essentially for free, this stuff doesn't really cost them anything. But I want to end with some of the things we can do by looking across all the data we have from dozens of companies all over the world, which is look at some big questions that have been really plaguing management for a while. And I just personally, I really hate when we use anecdotes to make large-scale policy decisions. And so with regards to gender, for example, you have people like Sheryl Sandberg who say, you know, basically if women just work differently, then we can expect different outcomes. Or you have people like Anne-Marie Slaughter who say, you know, the deck is just stacked against women. We really have to fundamentally change things. My question is just, well, what's reality? And just at a basic level, we have data on how people talk to each other, what networks people have, how likely are people to get promoted, how much people move around. And so at a basic level, the question we have is, all right, do men and women actually behave differently at work? So I pulled data, again, from thousands of our users. But the answer is there is no difference. Across every behavior we looked at, there was no significant difference in any of these behaviors. The variance was too high. So, okay, so, but we know, you know, that there's different outcomes in differences in outcomes between men and women. So maybe it's not just behavior. Maybe only the behaviors that are associated with promotions, maybe those are the things that matter, because it turns out we can predict promotions pretty accurately. No, there were no differences. All right, well, okay, there's one more thing that women can do that men can't do, and that's you're pregnant and have kids, right? Now, the thing about this is that, yes, you know, women take maternity leave and men don't really take paternity leave. Actually, you know, again, there's an egalitarian issue there that we'll sidestep for the moment. But the fact of the matter is that women take more time off than men when they have kids, so does this have an impact? And unfortunately, I do not have enough data to answer this. We only have a couple dozen users who've had kids. Great study out of Stanford, though, where they made fake resumes for job openings. But actually, all the resumes, the qualifications were the same. They just changed whether it was a man or a woman in the cover letter, whether they had kids or didn't have kids. And the most desirable candidates were men with kids. And when you ask in a laboratory study, you know, people viewed them as responsible. They're going to work really hard, again, to provide for their family. And then it was single men and single women. They were actually statistically identical. But by far, the least desirable candidates were women with kids. And so the issue here is not that we have really different behaviors at work. The issue is that it fundamentally comes down to bias. And bias sucks, because this is not something that I can change in a generation. This is something that takes decades to change. Listen, if you have leadership development programs, things like that for women, it's not to say that's not going to have an impact, but that's really ignoring the bigger question here. And so I just want to leave with just showing different versions of my book. I'm over time, but thank you very much for listening.
Ben didn't tell you he's on paternity leave right now, so he's always running experiments. So I'm sure he's wearing his badge and, you know, evaluating it on a daily basis. I'm thrilled to be here. I have had the privilege of working with both Ben and Rob on some projects, and they both are truly pioneers in what they do. This space is fascinating to me. I've grown up in the talent space. You know, we at General Motors have, you know, predictive models and thinking about talent and skills, and, you know, we've got some responsive models and looking at the pipeline and what we can do from a forecasting standpoint. But there's something missing. There's something missing in all these models, and the bias, using, you know, Ben's descriptor a few moments ago, is most of these models are biased towards human capital. You know, what is the capability of the individual? And would a better person, a higher quality hire, outperform somebody else? And you can run all the experiments and you can look at it, but I think the reason I'm so fascinated by this work is because it provides a different lens to evaluate where does somebody fit into their network and what impact does that have on performance. So what I hope to do, you know, over the next few moments is really run through two quick cases, very practical cases, one using the badges and one using, you know, broad organizational network analysis, and then translate that back to how we're using it for things like talent management and innovation in particular. So this first study was a study done actually not at General Motors, but it was a study done inside of a call center where we partnered with Ben and his team to look at the badges and to look at a call center. And the interesting thing about this was we were interested in how does the network drive productivity inside this call center. So there were 80 people. We put badges on them for 30 days. We evaluated how they were interacting with each other. The great part about this is we had dynamic data on the network every single day, and we could, you know, correlate that back to performance indicators at the individual level. So it was a highly sensitive study. And, you know, this, what we found out was the way that we were setting up this call center was the antithesis of what was driving performance in many ways. So, you know, the two primary measures in a call center, many of you probably know this, are average handle time, how quickly can you get off the phone and satisfy the customer's need, and efficiency. What percent of your overall time are you on the phone? And those are the ways you measure productivity. Well, as it turns out, that wasn't the right way to look at it. In fact, if you created more flex time, more face-to-face time, or more cohesion in the system, what happens is productivity actually increased, and you could actually, you know, handle more calls throughout the day at a less time, or lesser time, I should say, because the reality was the social interaction made a difference. And let me just share that. Here's the network. This was at the end of 30 days. There are four teams here, four teams of 20, and you can notice right away, the blue team and the magenta team are more cohesive. Can you see that in the chart? The other two teams are not. Not nearly as cohesive, and the reality is those two teams that were more cohesive were more productive. Those two teams actually had lower average handle times and literally had, you know, higher efficiency ratings in the way that we were measuring it for this study. So what do you do? Simple solutions. What do? Let's find a way to run some experiments to drive cohesion for all the teams. And in this particular organization, there were a billion interactions a year, you know, between customer service reps and customers, so you can see that the effects of something that can drive a 25% estimated improvement have radical impacts for the overall organization. And that's what we did. The simple solution that actually helped this one most was simply changing the break system to where people who were on the same team could break and go together and interact more. And what do you think they were talking about whenever they were doing that? They were talking about work. They were talking about the call that they just handled, and they were actually solutionizing how to respond whenever they get back on circuit in order to handle those issues later. The problem with the traditional system was it was very hierarchical. There was an escalation system, and you would escalate things through, you know, the ranks, get the formal solution, and push it back down. But if you know anything about call centers, they're episodic, and by the time you got the formal solution, the problem had already dissipated and gone away. This was localizing that and really driving cohesion in order to solve those issues much more promptly. The second study, and I realize this is an eye chart, but bear with me. The second study was really looking at organizational design. This was using survey methodologies, and this was immediately after a redesign where we started to ask ourselves questions, You know, do we have silos in this organization? Are we communicating across multiple geographies? And in particular, this was a network of over 300 people, 19 countries, and 5 major regions. So, and these groups had to work with each other. These subgroups, or subfunctions, we'll call them, had to work with each other. So we wanted to analyze it and see, did this redesign work? And the reality is, I actually felt pretty good about this study. And let me just highlight a couple points. You know, these two big clusters inside those circles are the two core parts of the organization that need to be working together. And in fact, they are, you can see. If you, you know, take a deeper dive into each of these elements of the network, those are exactly the people we would want to see interacting with each other on a daily basis. So we felt pretty relieved by that. We did have some silos. This was a silo group that initially concerned us, but then we went and analyzed who that group was, and we realized we're actually okay with that group being somewhat partitioned off from the organization because it's a back office activity. And the client service group, which seems to be the connectors back into the broader network, seem to be working. There's good distribution in the way that that group's interacting with everyone else, but on a day-to-day basis, they've got enough time to get their work done. But then there were some more interesting things and more nuanced things that we discovered. One of those silos is Korea. The other silo is Taiwan. So you might say, I'm not too concerned about it because they're small groups, right? Except for the fact that this was an English survey and there were many non-English speaking people that didn't participate in the survey, and most likely they're not connected into the broader network, which is predominantly English as well. What concerns me even more is this fact. There are 3 people holding those 2 parts of the overall network in. 3 people. By the way, 2 of those 3 people are expats. And at some point they'll rotate back into the core. And we've got a big problem all of a sudden, and we've got to think, what's the intervention? How do we manage that? How do we build better cohesion back into those 2 giant parts of the overall organization? Second big discovery as it relates to talent is these 4 people in particular. These are the hidden potential people. Rob talked a little bit about them. These are 4 people that were relatively unknown prior to us doing this study or this redesign, and the reality is they have become really critical elements of the new organization, really critical participants. And in fact, 2 of those 4 people have been promoted. This study was done 8 months ago. 2 of those people have been promoted because we now realize just what they were doing for the overall organization, and they were pulling it together, sharing. These are people that were really critical to creativity and innovation across this network because they were bridging what we would call structural holes in order to bring insight from one part of the network to another part of the network, and we're really instrumental in making that happen. Now, if you lose one of those people, as Rob also mentioned, you've got a problem. But the reality is knowing where they are and, you know, engaging them in a way that is critical is really essential to overall talent management. We would not have known that looking at traditional means of understanding talent. These 4 people weren't really on anyone's radar. They were fairly junior people in the overall system. And then finally, you know, there are a handful of people, 2 other segments I want to just spend a moment on. The pink dot there is someone who actually has left the organization at this stage. That was a person that we brought in from outside, recruited quite heavily, and just really didn't fit in chemistry-wise. All those connectivity or connection points there were outgoing connection points. You know, they had 10 outgoing connection points, but nobody was reaching back into this person. A bit quirky, you know, and didn't really fit into the culture in the way that we might have hoped. But the reality is that person has since gone, and had we known that and been managing that proactively, we may have handled it in a whole different way. The large red circle are a little bit of the de-energizer people. Somebody labeled this as we were doing this study, that's the soul-sucking circle. Those are the people that, you know, just really suck the soul out of the organization, and they're the negative people. The good news about this network is they're on the fringe right now, so they're not in the core, you know, but over time I would want to pay attention to what could happen if that negativity starts to seep back into the core, because it will cluster together, and what impact could that have? So this is an example. These are examples of how we're using this. We're looking at it from a talent management standpoint. We, of course, have the statistics at the individual level. We're starting to build it into some of our models, and we're looking at ways that we can scale this in such a manner that we're looking at. I think the tremendous opportunity for us in the future in this field is how do we link up human capital indicators with social capital indicators to get a full view of the potential of our organizations. So I will stop there.
Great, that was fascinating. So I'll start out with a question, and then I'm going to ask the panel some questions, and then I'll open up to the floor. So these are all really fascinating questions, and I mean presentations. And a lot of you, especially Rob and Michael, had touched upon certain network role, like bridging role, are really supposed to be the innovators, the people who actually have superior performance. So, and this is obviously a very fascinating area. We have, you know, email data, chats, also offline face-to-face interactions, and it feels like you can really capture a lot of the human dynamics that way. And my question is, do you think with this social network analysis, are we capturing characteristics of people such like, you know, like grits or psychological profile? That's kind of hard to change. So you're actually using that as a sorting mechanism to assign individual to roles? Or do you think the social network can be trained, that you can train certain people to become bridging role, you can train some people to become to have certain network characteristic? And if so, to what extent can you do that?
Sure. So I think it's you know 50-50, I'll say, you know, to take the easy way out to some degree. We have over 20 years, there's been a lot of times when we've captured network data and had access to Myers-Briggs, FIRO-B, you know, the big five, whatever it may be. And generally speaking, you know, you're about as likely to see an introvert as an extrovert in the center of the networks. There is a definite effect around self-monitoring as a personality characteristic that actually creates gaps in networks. There's a couple of combinations like the extroversion and the perceiving dimension, things like that. But it's not as strong as I would have thought going into this, right? And what we found generally is that if we can go into organizations and get the performance data as well, and then back away and say, what's unique about the networks of these top 20% performers or top 10% performers, then we can come back with very data-rich observations on what others can do to replicate those networks. And so it has to do most times not with the volume of ties. There's usually a negative relationship between the volume of connectivity and likelihood of becoming and staying a high performer. It's very much tied up in bridging ties, some of the, which the both presentations went through in different ways. It's hugely intertwined with being an energizer. There's one thing that has amazed me over 20 years is that simple question of do you create enthusiasm and interactions statistically is about 4 times the predictor of a high performer or somebody that gets in and importantly stays in that upwardly mobile trajectory through their career as anything else we've seen. And that's very behavioral. We've spent about 20 years going behind these network diagrams and asking the energizers, what do you think you do in these interactions? And then asking some of the energized, what do you think's going on? And there's 9 pretty specific behaviors that tend to really distinguish the energizers, some of which are intuitive, some of which aren't. So I think it is, you know, very able to be morphed if you take that kind of approach.
Yeah, so to build on that, one of the things that we've done with innovation in particular, and I think that's the other important thing, is you got to think about these networks contextually. So what is it that you're trying to do, and what is it that you're evaluating? So we spend a lot of time evaluating innovation and how do ideas flow. And looking at those bridging ties in particular is really critical because, you know, they are filling these structural holes. So one of the things that we did was we actually went out and did some ethnography watching those folks and trying to build patterns in regards to what are they doing differently than, you know, the average person that's managing, you know, the day-to-day business. And we're beginning to discover some interesting patterns, but it's very nuanced, and it's unless you're out there observing it and watching how these people are sort of decoding the organization, it's hard to interpret that in any traditional analytics, if you will.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the thing I would say is that I'd echo what both Rob and Mike were saying. At the same time, things like, obviously, the way you the culture of the company, the environment that you set up, heavily influences the way these things form. I think you saw it a little bit when I showed the diagram of the two branches, where you saw that the one branch where you had two groups that weren't connected, basically because people sat on different floors. You know, but basically, trivially, if I take you and I lock you in a broom closet on the 15th floor and all your coworkers on the second floor, unless we really need to talk to you, you're going to be peripheral, right? And obviously that's an extreme example, but I think there's a lot of decisions we make in organizations, like where we sit, you know, do we eat lunch together? Things like how big lunch tables are. The things where we've actually seen an impact on how those shape the networks. And so again, individually, you are doing things obviously to shape your own network, and your role can influence that. But at the same time, you have to realize that as a company, the environment you're setting up heavily influences the way these things develop.
Any questions?
While we have people getting up, I'll just tell an anecdote on this one. This is we've done a lot for a while on internal work in the security agencies to see how they're collaborating to solve, you know, different kinds of threats, not so much externally per se, but one of the funniest things is I went into one context and you could see there were silos that were very predictable, you know, that they needed to address to get better at not just having a Cold War mentality, but to do certain things differently. But there was this knot in the network that nobody could really understand why it existed. And this is at one of our very well-known security agencies, right, protecting our lives here in various ways. And we finally walked out on the floor to see what was predicting it, and it turned out that that was where this massive bowl of M&Ms sat on a lady's desk. And I'm thinking, therein lies our national security, right? So there's a tremendous amount around physical configuration that, despite all the media, really continues to have a pretty big effect in different ways.
Well, we see a lot of questions. Let's start with Lily over there.
Thank you. So a lot of companies are actually putting in digital platforms to try and connect people across organizations that may not naturally come together. Have you done any work with seeing how connections on those digital platforms actually compare to connections that people are doing through their work, and are there potential overlaps? Are they potential proxies for the network?
Maybe I'll try to answer that fairly briefly. Yeah, so we see a bunch of interesting things, which is basically that if I sit next to you or we talk a lot in person, we actually do, there actually is a strong relationship to digital communication. Different communication channels, though, do look different in the sense that the email network looks different than the IM network, looks different than, say, the Yammer network if you use an internal social media. And there's lots of people, there's companies like ourselves, but also Volumetrics outside doing a lot of that sort of work. What at least we've seen from sort of combining all that data is that if I don't know you, I'm not going to email you. I'm not going to IM you. Maybe I'll occasionally talk to you over like an internal social media platform, but it's very, very basic. And it's still, ironically, very driven by distance. And sure, we all work in like, you know, we have global teams where I got to talk to the guy in India. I got to talk to the person in Japan. But really, the way that you can get those things to work effectively, like, we're still very, very bad at getting those groups to work together well.
Great. Thank you.
Let's have the lady in the middle.
Yes. Have you gotten any feedback from your employees regarding maybe privacy issues or them feeling like there's any intrusion or Big Brother kind of?
Never. No one ever. No one ever.
The elephant in the room, right?
Are you the attorney in the room?
I would not feel comfortable so I'm just asking. Yeah. I love data, but I don't know how comfortable.
Actually, I can piggyback off that one with my question as well, because I think from a management perspective, it's quite clear what the benefits are, and management will be quickly sold on this. And some in my organization, 40,000 in the U.S., 200,000 worldwide, so there's a lot of data to collect. Yeah. But at the same time, do you see issues with individuals feeling uncomfortable with like the Big Brother effect, or are there generational factors at play, or do you sort of prep people with a mindset shift or organizational readiness shift to collect this data?
So I'll hit on this because it was a big deal for us too, kind of early on in terms of how we share. The strength of these ideas is that you can rifle shot into a situation that traditionally you've been shotgunning, in certain ways. The weakness of these ideas is you can rifle shot in, right? And if you don't handle that data well, then you're in trouble. So I never go into a place and put a diagram up and start asking, why is this guy out on the edge? Or that sort of thing, because it's not productive. But what we do have are certain analytics that, for example, show heat maps of where collaborations are breaking down across geographies or units or capability domains or things like that. So, and it's very different. That's been the thing that probably more than anything else has amazed me, is there are some companies you can go into and they can deal very well with the data just culturally, right? They're able to take it and take action on it. And then there's others that you have to disguise everything to make it, actionable. But that's, to me, is always a really important kind of upfront set of discussions around what level of transparency, communicating that clearly. And then I think really importantly is we usually give individualized results back to each person that's taking the survey. so that there is a positive reason for them to do it and you know, get their engagement in it. So.
Go ahead. Sure, I'll talk really briefly about what we do, which is that we deploy our technology on an opt-in basis. We don't give individual data to companies. We don't record what you say, and we don't count how many times you go to the bathroom. Right? We give everyone a consent form, which shows the database tables that we collect. We sign it saying we won't give your individual data there. So we're just very upfront with what we do. We've gotten over a 90% participation rate in every rollout we've done. You actually own your own data. But I think that's really important for what we do and for this whole industry as a whole.
The only thing I would add to that is we use an opt-in basis as well, so no one has to participate if they're not interested. The other piece is, you know, clear contracting on the front end. What will this data be used for? What won't it be used for?
Yeah.
And just being crystal clear on those expectations from the very outset.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you.